Instead, she is now a member of the Northumbrian royal family. She is the half-sister of King Oswy, and she is not the abbess of Coldingham, but the Latinized version of that name, Coldingham. Moreover, Bede provides far more clues as to where that monastery was located. Most of you will be familiar with the story of the two sea creatures who tried St. Cuthbert's feet when he emerged from the waves in the middle of the night. In the anonymous life, the distance between the seashore and St. Aebbe's monastery of Coldingham is not mentioned. Cuthbert merely, quote, began to walk about by night on the seashore. Bede, however, is a little bit more explicit. Cuthbert went down to the sea above whose shores the monastery was built. A monk stood and watched from the cliffs as two otters joined him with their fur. The next and last reference to Aebbe for about 400 years is in Bede's Historia Ecclesiastica, which was written around the year, or was finished in the year 731. Having had a subsidiary role in the cult of Cuthbert, she now played a minor role in Bede's account of St. Ethelthryth. Ethelthryth, having finally persuaded her husband, the Northumbrian King Egfrith, to let her take the veil, entered the monastery where Aebbe, who incidentally was Egfrith's auntie, was the abbess. And once again, Bede gives the name of this monastery as Coldingham. So what sort of portrait can be sketched from these scraps of information? Bede may well have been a widow. She was a nun, an abbess, and given that high status role, very likely that she was a member of the Northumbrian royal family. She was friends with elite churchmen. Her monastery, sited on or near a possible defensive structure associated with a personal name, Colude, and it lay not far from the seashore, possibly on a headland above the sea. That's about it. But perhaps it doesn't really matter. In his Historia Ecclesiastica, Bede related the vision of the pious Irish monk Admiral, who had foretold the destruction of Coldingham on account of the wickedness and wantonness of the monks and nuns who lived there. This had already come to pass when he was writing in 731, and if we believe the entry in the 9th century Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, the fire which devastated the monastery occurred in 679. Aebbe's 7th century foundation may only have stood for perhaps as many as 40 or 50 years. So what did it matter if the accounts lacked geographical precision? Coldingham was already a decades-old ruin. And besides, Aebbe was a mere abbess, perhaps a friend to saints, Cuthbert, Ethelthryth, but she was not a saint herself. What this paucity of early information in fact tells us is that Aebbe was not noteworthy. No record of her life was required. With her monastery destroyed, there was no ongoing community to celebrate her memory or venerate her as a saint. I hope it still works. And that would have been that, had it not been for the Kings of Scotland and the Cathedral Priory of Durham. I want to now turn to look a little bit at the legend of St. Aebbe, because I think this is the most interesting thing about her. This is a legend that developed during the 12th century, but before we look at detail at the substance of this legend, I want to look at the context behind its development. So I'm going to start with the Prior of Coldingham. We've already talked about the fabulous arcading here in Harris from the 12th century. The actual foundation here was probably sometime around 1098. Edgar, the King of the Scots, had granted the church and the estates of Coldingham to the monks of Durham, and a genuine writ of William II of England, who died in 1100, confirms Edgar's grant. So this is a particularly reliable piece of dating for the origins of Durham's ownership of Coldingham. Substantial endowments by Scottish kings, notably David I, ecclesiastics and other magnates, followed during the early 12th century. A grange, a monastic outpost oversee these far-flung estates, had probably been established in Coldingham in 1098, But as Durham's Scottish landholdings grew and became increasingly prosperous, the church at Coldingham was transformed into a regular conventual priory. And whereas hitherto monks from Durham would have presumably visited on a cyclical basis, now Coldingham was home to a permanent community of Benedictine monks. A reference to monks serving the church at Coldingham in 1139 indicates the priory was established by this date, and a prior, who's known only by the initial H, was mentioned in the writ of 1147. So by the mid-13th century, Coldingham had become one of the wealthiest and most prominent of all of Durham's eight daughter houses. And the proposal in around the year 1235 that there should always be 30 resident monks at Coldingham, bear in mind that Durham only had 70 themselves, indicates that the priory had considerable resources. That's the story of the priory, but where does Aebbe come into this? The first reference to Aebbe after Bede in the 8th century is found in the Libellus De Exordio, a history of the community of Durham, written by Simeon of Durham in the early 12th century, who died in around the year 1129. He alleged that the relics of Aebbe had been found and taken to Durham by the then sacrist Alfred Wester around the year 1020, where they had been interred in the shrine of St. Cuthbert, alongside the bones of several other northern saints who had been similarly collected: Bede, Aidan, Boisil, Edbert, Edfrith, Ethelwald. A 12th century relic list itemising the bones found in 1104 when the tomb and the shrine of St. Cuthbert was opened includes those of St. Aebbe. Now, the early 11th century is known as an era for saint-making, when long-lost relics of long-forgotten saints, particularly northern saints, were unearthed and removed to larger religious communities where they could be better cared for and celebrated. Archbishop Odo started this craze in the year 948 when he removed the relics of St. Wilfrid from Ripon to Canterbury, and then Bishop Ethelwald translated the remains of Benedict Bishop to Thorney in 980. And in the early 11th century, Glastonbury Abbey claimed to have taken possession of the relics of Hilda, Aidan, Bede, and Boisil. So Simeon's claims made a century later were largely issued to refute this allegation that Glastonbury had all of these relics. Aebbe's bones were not removed, or claimed to be removed, because she was a saint. She became a saint because her bones were moved. Two things are clear from Simeon's Libellus and the Durham relic list. Not only was Aebbe now treated as a saint, but there was a tradition among the Durham monks in the early 12th century that they possessed Aebbe's relics and had done so for the last 100 years. The fact that this claim was voiced at around the same time the Church of Durham began to acquire assets in Coldingham is significant. Being already possessed of her relics would have strengthened their sense of entitlement to the estates. It legitimised their possession of land north of the border. But what we must not forget is that the first monks of Coldingham, coming as they did from the Mother Church at Durham, would have been familiar with this tradition. And this is what makes the later development of her legend so difficult to understand. During the reign of the Scottish King David I, numerous grants were awarded to the Priory of Coldingham. These were made out to, quote, Blessed Mary and St. Cuthbert, the two dedicatees of the Priory Church. But in 1182, we find a writ addressed to Mary Cuthbert and St. Aebbe. Her name had been added to the church dedication, indicating that a cult to the abbess had been established at Coldingham. But of greater significance is the production of texts containing an account of her life and the miracles that she had performed, the Vita et Miracula Sancti Aebbe. This life survives now in just one single manuscript. It's now in the Bodleian Library. It's a collection collection of chronicles and saints' lives written at Durham during the second half of the 14th century. The text itself probably dates to the late 12th century, possibly early 13th century. It tells the story of a local man named Henry who had a vision in which he was told to build an oratory. During this vision, he had imagined himself at, quote, Coldingham, where he met two old men in white cloaks with bright faces and white hair, who were going around a mountain searching for something. They complained to Henry about the desolateness of the place and told Henry to construct an oratory in honour of the Lord and of the Holy Virgin Aebbe. This he did, to much mockery, since it seemed to many a ridiculous undertaking. But in that crudely built oratory, perched on the top of the headland, miracles began to happen. According to the Vita, this vision, it's called a revelatio, occurred in 1188. The Vita proceeds to explain that Henry's oratory had since been demolished, and a new, larger oratory had been built in the same place by the brethren of Coldingham. This oratory, quote, can be seen at the present time, and here sick people gain the benefit of health, and faithful the petitions they longed for. So the vision establishes TPQ for the Vita. It must have been written after 1188, but how much later? We don't know. If we knew who had written it, we might be better able to narrow down the when, but its author has yet been identified. It has been ascribed to Reginald of Durham, a well-known 12th century hagiographer, but it in fact bears very little similarity to his other work. There are a couple of other candidates, but there is really no conclusive evidence. We don't know who, we don't know when, but we do know where. It was written here in Coldingham for the Brethren of Durham by a former inmate of the Cathedral Priory. The prologue starts. The venerable presence of the body of our Holy Father Cuthbert supports you. Whenever I consider this, I pine for my own land like a wanderer and a stranger. I, who cannot participate in your glory, therefore fly to the protection of Saint Aebbe. I am sending to your holiness a little gift of a sermon about her life and miracles. To describe it as a sermon, as opposed to a life, a vita, is certainly far more appropriate. It amounts to little more than a story received from hearsay, a rehashing of the accounts of the monastery's destruction found in the Historia Ecclesiastica, and a rather lengthy and confusing exegesis. The story, styled as a familiar story handed down by our forefathers, is a curious one and should be told in its entirety. So Aebbe was sought in marriage, however, by a tyrant of the Scots called Aidan, whom Bede mentions in his History of the English. Because she rejected him, he eventually decided to take her by force and pursued her with both love and violence. It is said, presumably by these forefathers, that she took refuge at Monte Coludi, and that at her prayers, the sea rising itself from the south and overflowing the course of the adjacent valley, for 3 days obstructed the enemy and provided some protection for a fortification of the Virgin with the Lord's help. This is a familiar story among the populace and has been handed down by our forefathers, so it seems right to maintain it, since in addition it seems to have left a trace in the nature of that terrain. I'm going to come back to this rather enigmatic final sentence in a little while. We are then provided with three exemplars, since, quote, things are believed far more easily if they can be supported by a similar happening. So we are reminded of the story of the sea which parted, providing a dry path for the monks carrying Cuthbert's body, and of course Moses parting the Red Sea for the fleeing Israelites in Exodus. However, fit isn't quite right. Aebbe's miracle is in fact an inversion of these events. A slightly more apt tale is told of a thief whose escape was thwarted by the sea rising against him, but which receded once he had repented. And similarly, once Aidan had departed, the sea retreated to its normal place. It seems that the author believed that Aebbe built her monastery on Mond The narrative continues. That headland, Mons, was once resplendent with tall buildings, but afterwards it was turned into a level wasteland by the wickedness of those who lived there. And of course we're now back in that familiar being Adam and story, and it just kind of continues from there. But one of the things I find so interesting about this text is the degree of description we find. Hagiographical texts rarely indulge in these florid descriptions of either places or people, yet here we are given a very precise account of the headland. There is a rock situated above the sea, round in shape like an egg, its northern face being larger, while to the south its sides slowly converge almost to a point. It rises so high that the favour of nurture girds it with its own height and defends it from rough surroundings. It is connected to the surrounding hills by a very wide valley. It is hard to climb and hard to reach, but to the north and south it is approached by narrow paths, not without fear of the precipices which plunges downwards, while to the west it rises to a peak and a little hill, and then slopes eastwards to an uneven flat surface where the oratory of the Blessed Virgin can be seen. It has two fountains as a comfort to its solitude and hermit life, a higher spring and a lower spring. For one furnishes perpetual moisture with its waters at the roots of the hill, the other at the top of the hill dries up in the summer heat and presents only a ditch to those seeking water. Many invalids and sick people have obtained their former health through drinking their healing waters. The Blessed Virgin and the holy companions of her congregation drank from these fountains. To the author of the Vita Miracula and the other ex-Durham monks who took up permanent residency in Coldingham, the 7th century foundation of Coldingham was located on the high headland which overlooked the sea, some 2 miles away from the 12th century foundation. Moreover, I'm sorry, this isn't her tomb, by the way. Just throwing that out there. It's from Yorkshire, so please don't get excited. Moreover, the Coldingham monks clearly believed that the spot where Aebbe had originally been buried. Sandwiched between the Vita and the Miracula is what is known in hagiography as an inventio, an account of the discovery of the relics, but not the discovery made by Alfred Westo in 1020, but a far more recent episode which took place after the establishment of the Priory of Coldingham. According to our anonymous author, a group of shepherds had found a tomb in Urbo Quoque Coludi. They tried to open it with their crooks, but they were struck by sudden blindness and insanity. The inhabitants of the place brought the tomb to the church of St. Mary at Coldingham, where it was inspected by the brethren. One of the monks put his hands into the coffin where it had broken, and he felt some linen and small bones, but he was struck by a sudden pain in his limbs and died shortly after. The brethren, fearful, enclosed the coffin in stone, and our elders, the author wrote, put all this, as apparent to everyone and consonant with the truth, into a little book. At some unspecified period of time later, the monks decided to try to open the coffin, and their resolve was strengthened after one of the older monks had a vision of Aebbe herself, who urged him to put aside all his reservations. The monk, the author declares, was still alive at the time of writing and accustomed to tell the tale. I think I might just lost my mic. Can you still hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. After a lengthy account of the engineering and logistics required, the author describes what the brethren found inside the coffin. Looking inside, they saw dust in the shape of a human body, and untouched until now by human hands. No bones appeared there as yet. When they put their hands in, the shape of dust dissolved. They searched through the dust, which had been kept moist until now because of the cold, in the sunshine, and sieved it, and collected the bones together, then arranged them in a new shrine, which they placed on the altar, where it could be revered worthily. This is a confusing development. A text written by an ex-member of the Durham community now residing in Coldingham, directly contradicting the tradition and claims of the Church of Durham. And our author is particularly strident on this point. He says, quote, "If anyone contends the large bones have been taken away, let him bring to mind the intact dust. Others may flatter themselves that they have her holy relics. Let them rejoice to have them and be happy to venerate them. Let us rejoice that we are not lacking in them and celebrate having touched them with our hands." And this is quite the boast, particularly in a text addressed to a community who believed that the relics of St. Aebbe lay interred in their shrine at St. Cuthbert and not on a reliquary at the altar of St. Mary's Church in Coldingham. But there is another twist. In the miracle stories that follow, rarely was Aebbe's reliquary or the tomb that remained in the church mentioned as sites of healing cures. Of the 40 plus miracles described, only four were performed at the tomb, and a further two at some unspecified location within the church. Contrast this with a whopping 34 miracles said to have performed at the oratory on the top of Coludy Erbs. As we know, the original oratory was built by a local man named Henry after he was inspired in a vision. This would have been a rather modest structure erected from mud and roughly hewn rocks. The proliferation of miracles at this site, however, transformed, quote, "contempt into reverence, mockery into praise, ignorance into glory." And the brethren who had scoffed at Henry tore down his homemade efforts and erected a new, larger oratory. In 1836, the antiquarian A.A. Carr wrote that the walls of the chapel, quote, "and a small Saxon arch were to be seen till within these few years, between 3 and 4 feet in height, upon an elevated mound near the eastern extremity of the wild headland and close to the very verge of the precipice." Later accounts describe a two-cell chapel with a chancel measuring approximately 6.5 metres by 7 and a nave 17 metres by 9. And it was here, in this cold, remote chapel, that pilgrims would spend the night awaiting their miracle cure, not camped out in Coldingham Church. It is remarkable that, having laid claim to possess Aebbe's relics, the author then proceeds to deflect attention from both the saint's tomb and the corporeal remains, the typical targets for pilgrim devotion. Not only does the focus the miraculous shift to the headland, but on the journey itself, on the physical performance of pilgrimage. Our anonymous Coldingham author takes pains not only to locate the cult at the oratory on top of the headland, but to delineate a prescribed route through that landscape. Six of the miracles depict pilgrims drinking and washing in a spring at the foot of a hill beneath the oratory. They would typically visit this spring and then climb to visit the oratory. One miracle recounts the story of a young girl who had lost her voice following a demonic attack. Quote, "coming to the fountain, which the local people call the Spring of the Blessed Aebbe, she washed her mouth and face. Immediately it seemed that the Blessed Aebbe placed a finger in her mouth, and straight away the bond of her tongue was loosened. Coming at once to the oratory of the Blessed Aebbe, she spent the night there in vigils and prayer." Another miracle describes a local man who had a piece of goose bone lodged in his throat. He was advised to try the nearby shrine of St. Aebbe. And again, quote, "he accepted this salutary advice, rushing up at a swift pace. He drank 3 times from the spring, which is at the foot of the mountain. He entered the oratory and gave himself up in prayer." Others, who may have dispensed with this stage and proceeded directly to the oratory, are in fact instructed, through visions of Aebbe, to return and wash in the spring and then come back up. So a blind woman, guided by her small daughter, came to the oratory to pray for her sight. During the night, as she lay sleeping, Aebbe appeared to her in a vision and said to her, Go to the foot of the mountain and wash in my fountain. Go to the foot of the mountain, wash in my fountain, and your sight will be restored. The woman awoke, quote, determined to seek the fountain, and going round the mountain and the places below it without anyone to guide her or show her the way, she found it. She washed, the darkness completely dispersed, and she received the gift of sight as before. Another young man was given similar instructions. In his case, his right hamstring was severely contracted, so much so that his foot had twisted back into his buttocks and worn a channel in the skin. As he lay sleeping at the oratory, he was visited by the Blessed Virgin, who told him that he should go to her spring and wash in the afflicted place. He went down, washed, and returned to the oratory to receive his cure. In some cases, the order in which these places were visited is unclear. A blind man came there, led by his wife, and as dawn came up on the third day, when he had anointed his eyes with water from the spring, as he had been instructed in the dream, he recovered his sight. Now, presumably this man had spent the two preceding nights at the oratory, where, as with others, he had been told to visit the spring through a vision. So reading between the lines of the miracula, we find a clearly demarcated system of supplication involving sequential visits to selected sites in the landscape. It's not uncommon for pilgrimage centres to be surrounded by what has been described as a sacralised topography of chapels, holy wells, and wayside crosses. In their anthropological study of modern and medieval Catholic pilgrimage, Victor and Edith Turner explained that these lesser shrines operate like sacred valves, which deliberately impede the pilgrim's progress. These resistances, they say, are designed to build up a considerable load of reverent feeling, so that the final ingress to the holiest shrine of all will be for each pilgrim a momentous matter. In the Middle Ages, this sacralized topography was nowhere more evident than in the Holy Land and the Holy City of Jerusalem itself. And although the precise itinerary changed over the century according to political circumstances, a variety of sites associated with the life of Christ led the pilgrims to their ultimate goal, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And such carefully managed ritual spaces was also evident at more domestic pilgrimage centres. So pilgrims visiting Canterbury Cathedral, where Archbishop Thomas Becket had been murdered in 1170, were channeled past the exact spot of his martyrdom before descending down into the crypt to visit his tomb. By the late Middle Ages, the Holy House of Walsingham in Norfolk, established after a vision of the Virgin in the 11th century, was enveloped in a much larger ritual complex which included a chapel of St. Lawrence and two holy wells. While at St. David's in West Wales, early Christian sites and monuments were consciously co-opted by the promoters of the cult of St. David. Keen to improve the prestige of their church and press their claims to metropolitan status, successive hagiographers sought to situate the legend of St. David into a local ritual landscape. So pre-existing cemeteries, holy wells, chapels, stone crosses were written into the saint's hagiography, thus binding the saint to the local district and establishing a composite pilgrimage site with multiple foci for veneration. The miraculous Saint Aebbe gives a similar impression of a richly managed landscape bearing the visible imprints of her of the legend. The question, however, is whose legend? If you remember a short while ago, I was talking about Aebbe's flight to the headland and how the author claimed that it was a familiar story passed down by generations. He made an appeal to the local topography for its truth. He said of the story that it seems right to maintain it, since it seems to have left its trace in the nature of that terrain. Now, we aren't told what this physical trace was, nor how it related to the legend. He seems to have missed out a crucial part of this supposedly local story. But I've been wondering whether it is actually as local as he claimed. One of the most extraordinary things about the story of Aebbe is the discovery of an identical tale in the life of St. Ethelthryth. Mm-hmm. If we recall Bede's Historia Ecclesiastica, Ethelthryth was married to King Egfrith, who was Ebb's nephew, but with her husband's permission, Ethelthryth took the veil at Ebb's monastery of Coludi Erbs. Egfrith hadn't been particularly thrilled by the idea of his wife becoming a nun, but he did finally agree and he gave her his blessing. Now, this version of events was retold in at least two more 11th century vita. But in the 12th century, an entirely different tradition version emerged. In Book 1 of the Liber Aliensis, a text recording the history and the privileges of the Abbey of Ely, we find a life of Ethelthryth, the Abbey's foundress. Here we learn of a sorrowful Egfrith, grief-stricken with loss, who attempted to forcibly remove Ethelthryth from the monastery. According to the Liber Aliensis, the disconsolate king arrived at the monastery, in the place quem coludi nominant urbem, with fury and a great hullabaloo. Fearful for her chastity, Ethelthryth fled to the nearby headland called Coldburcaservet, which we are told means Coldburc's head. Sounds remarkably familiar. She climbed the headland, and once stationed at the summit, the sea rose, flooding the neighbouring land and turning the hilltop into an island. The king, unable to cross the vast expanse of water, eventually gave up his pursuit. The floodwaters lingered for 7 nights, leaving Ethelthryth and her two handmaids, Sawina and Sawara, without drinking water. In answer to their prayers, however, water gushed forth from a dry rock to quench their thirst. According to the unknown author of this life, who had apparently received this tale from those living in the locality of Colud, the spring still flowed as evidence and was considered an effective cure for the sick. Moreover, the author adds, quote, something worthy of record and incomparably wonderful is that the footprints of that Ethelthryth made when going up and down were moulded into the side of the cliff as though in hot wax, and are even now pointed out in glorification of the Lord Jesus Christ. So in this text we are left in absolutely no doubt about the visible proof this tale left in the local terrain. So how are we supposed to interpret this development and explain the occurrence and identical story in two separate saints' legends? According to the editor, the modern editor of the Liber Aliensis, Book 1 was probably completed around the year 1131. This is some 50 years before a cult of Ebb started in any earnest here in Coldingham. Did the anonymous author of Ebb's Vita simply cut and paste from the Liber Aliensis? But where did the author of the Liber Aliensis get his material? Could there be any truth in his claim to have received it from the local community? In short, we don't know. But I do have a theory. The account in the Liber Aliensis is radically different, particularly in his portrayal of Egfrith, from all of the other earlier accounts of Ethelthryth. But there is a really interesting metrical life, and this is a long narrative poem which had been written just a short while before. And while this account doesn't actually mention the miracle of the saint's flight to the headland or the rising sea, the figurative language used by the poet does lend itself to a sort of imaginative reconstruction of just such a scenario. This, for example, is the stanza which I argue may have given rise to the miracle. It actually sounds much better in the Latin, but I'll read the English. It's much easier. She fled from Egypt, she fled the forsaken Pharaoh, and while she fled Sodom, she did not look back at Gomorrah, neighbouring Sodom. She fled from Segor as well as Gomorrah, fearing fires until she reached a secure mountain. In describing Ethelthryth's flight, the author draws exclusively on Old Testament analogies. Egfrith is the cruel pharaoh to Ethelthryth, the fleeing Israelite. The marital bed and the secular world, the twin dens of iniquity of Sodom and Gomorrah. And not only does the Liber Aliensis share this kind of pharaonic-inspired characterization of Egfrith, But the miracle of the rising sea recollects, as we know, albeit inadvertently, the Red Sea's defence of the Israelites. Moreover, Lot's flight from the fire and brimstone raining down on Sodom and Gomorrah is a two-stage affair. He fled first to the city of Segor and then to Monte Securo. If we recall, Ethelthryth fled first to the monastery at Caludi Erz and then to the headland known as Coldbert's Head. It's not hard to see how metaphors drawn from the stories told in the books of Exodus and Genesis may have provided the building blocks for a much more embellished narrative that could be applied to a real life, albeit distant, landmark. Nor would the author of the Librariensis have lacked hagiographical examples. In the 11th century life of the merchant Saint Milba, the miraculous swelling of the river Corve gave Milba the opportunity to shake off her lecherous suitor, a certain pagan king of the Welsh. And a similar tale was even found about Ethelthryth's sister, Sexbert, when the rising of the River Thames prevented Archbishop Theodore from leaving the Isle of Sheppey, forcing him to accept the saint's hospitality. I think most people are quite anxious to leave the Isle of Sheppey. Sorry, I live in Kent, so of course, even if we accept the miracle in the Librariensis was a literary fabrication, it doesn't mean that it didn't reach Coldingham by word of mouth. It is perfectly possible that in the intervening 50 years, the story spread to the Scottish borders where, unsurprisingly, it shifted onto the shoulders of a figure closer to hand. Perhaps the spread of the Librariensis north of the border during the course of the 12th century even provided the catalyst for the revival of interest in the cult of Aebbe and the establishment of this as a prominent cult at Coldingham. What is clear, though, is that this story of the flight to the headland, embedded as it was in the local landscape, was an integral part of Aebbe's cult and lay at the heart of the 12th century pilgrimage experience. As I said earlier, one of the things that fascinates me about the life of Aebbe is the unusual degree of description. The author takes great pains to emphasise the physicality of the headland, its remote location and its perilous access routes. Its scarped slopes present the challenge even to the most able-bodied. So in order to mix the mortar with which to build his oratory, Henry, quote, carried water in a little cask placed on the cart from the foot of the mountain up the rocky path across the side of the steep mountain. For those with sight or mobility problems, it must have been an even more risky and arduous task. A man, quote, crippled in the knees, who was not able to get along except by crawling on his hands and knees, came to the oratory with great difficulty. And I can imagine, I went and had a walk over there this afternoon, and it would be very difficult if you had any problems. For another pilgrim who walked bent over with a staff, it was a punishing undertaking. For, quote, while one foot moved freely, the heel of the other one was twisted upwards and he had to touch the ground with his fingers, making more of a leap than a step. One Saturday, when people were flocking in haste from the surrounding hamlets to the mountain and the oratory, as was their custom, he too began to go, and travelling painfully like a slow tortoise, from the ninth hour of the day until evening, he at last arrived there. So the climb to the oratory, though steep and hazardous, was not the only physically demanding aspect of the route. Before the pilgrims arrived at the foot of the mountain, they had to cross a wide valley. This in itself was no easy feat. In 1836, Carr described it as having been an impassable quagmire. Moreover, Carr mentions that several fragments of timber were dug up when attempts were made to drain the valley at the end of the 18th century, and he supposed these to have been landstalls of the drawbridge by which it may have been crossed. So the route demarcated in the miraculous ushered pilgrims bound for the oratory through boggy, saturated ground to the spring used by Aebbe and her companions, and then to the hilltop where she had sought refuge. In following this path, the pilgrims were, in essence, retracing the events told in the Vita. Physical participation required of each pilgrim, picking their way through the swampy ground, drinking and washing in the spring, making their way along the side of the mountain, were mimetic rituals. In performing them, the pilgrim was reenacting the narrative, bridging the gap in their imagination between themselves in the 12th century and Aebbe in the 7th, whom, they were told, turned not only to the mountain, but to Christ for her deliverance. It is very tempting to theorise that superimposed upon the legend was a sophisticated exegesis, a spiritual explanation for the events which provided the pilgrims with the intellectual apparatus through which they should interpret their experience. We've already seen in relation to Ethelthryth, but similarly with Aebbe, the flight and the rising sea, which were called elements in Genesis and Exodus, was certainly given a biblical and indeed a Hebraic coloration. The miracles performed in the oratory on top of the headland, however, carry echoes of Christ and his transfiguration on Mount Tabor. Experiencing saintly apparitions was far from common. In over 2,000 miracle stories from the 11th and 12th centuries in France, only 255, that's just 12%, reported visions of saints. In Aebbe's case, the figure was far higher. We have 57%. She would typically appear to the pilgrim as they slept or prayed. Several of those cured described her as wearing white garments. One claimed she even appeared in a nun's habit. She usually appeared in the east, and in one case she was even reported to have been sitting on the holy altar. Such visions were highly unusual. Indeed, the author commented, quote, "It is amazing and a remarkable thing in miracles that she who wished to heal wished also to be seen manifestly and recognized by those whom she healed." So while in the Vita, Aebbe was a figuration of Moses, in the miraculous, she became identified with Christ. The pilgrims lying prostrate in vigil in the oratory are thus equated with the watching apostles, Peter, James, and John, who witnessed Christ's transfiguration. In Christian teachings, transfiguration is a pivotal moment, and the setting on the mountain is presented as a point where human nature meets God, with Jesus himself as the connecting point, acting as the bridge between heaven and earth. As I said, while it'd be really tempting to suggest that this text provided pilgrims with an intellectual framework through which they could come to recognise that Christ was the true source not only of their cure but their salvation, this in itself requires a leap of faith. It presumes the promulgation of texts such as this among the pilgrim community, a practice for which there is no direct evidence. Historians are often content to recycle the claim that hagiography was written for propagandist purposes or edificatory purposes, but they fail to inquire how Latin texts were disseminated to an inferred lay audience. While there is some anecdotal evidence for monks preaching to the laity on the subject of a saint's life and miracles, this was far from a common occurrence. More problematic for us is the fact that the Vita et Miraculis Sancte Aebbe was written for the monks at Durham, and that the manuscript containing the sole copy of this text has a Durham provenance. There is absolutely no evidence at all to suggest that this text was known or used at Coldingham, much less disseminated to the transient pilgrim community who gathered there. Yet this does not necessarily mean that pilgrims visiting Coldingham were unaware either of the practices they were expected to perform or the spiritual exegesis which underlay them. On the contrary, while the author may have been responsible for turning experience into words, the stories which he received were already narrative productions, which drew on a shared linguistic and cultural framework. Even before this unknown hagiographer set to work moulding these stories to fit his agenda, they would have already exhibited what anthropologists Coleman and Esner have termed pre-patterning, I think they actually coined these words, but I've never heard them before, formulaicity and idiomaticity. Yeah. Okay. As the pilgrims searching for words in which to describe their own miraculous experience would have subconsciously reached for those of others. Whereas Williams described early modern pilgrims to the Holy Land, quote, speaking not so much in their own persons, not on their own behalf, but at others' behests and in borrowed voices. Most likely in circulation at Coldingham was a shared discourse communicated orally among the pilgrim community that told of the proper way to negotiate the journey to the oratory and to prepare for a miracle cure. And this, I think, is the best attempt that I can make at reconciling so many of the quite frankly baffling aspects of Aebbe's legend. While I remain, I think, a little bit at a loss to account for the boast to possess her relics, I wonder whether this text, the Vita et Miracula, represents a formal apologia, a defence for a popular cult which emerged in Coldingham in the late 12th century. Inspired perhaps by rumours originating in East Anglia, the local but largely obscure figure of Aebbe quickly supplanted the story's original protagonist, and it gathered momentum. The brethren here at Coldingham, under strict obligation perhaps, to explain to their mother house why they were permitting a popular cult to flourish away from a centralised ecclesiastical control, commissioned one of their number to write an account which sanctioned their actions according to a standard Christian theology. The result, the Latin Life and Miracles of St. Aebbe, was thus a legitimisation of a local landscape-based cult which brought prestige, interest, and perhaps most importantly, pilgrim money to the newly founded Priory of Coldingham.
Very good.